Welcome to worship this evening at 10th. We're going to hear the word of God, we'll pray together, and then we'll sing our opening hymn, which is number 8. At the end of Psalm 99, it says this: "Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his holy mountain, for the Lord our God is holy." Our Father God, we come to you this evening and we're reminded that you are utterly different from us. You are holy, meaning that you are above us. In your splendor, you are apart from us in your being. And we find ourselves at an infinite moral distance from you because of our sin. And yet wonderfully, wonderfully, you call us into fellowship with yourself. Wonderfully, you seek us like the shepherd seeks out his flock. And you care for us and you lead us into paths and ways of righteousness for your name's sake. You restore our souls. You come and you again and again and again ravish us with promises of your great and eternal love for us. And every day you bestow your kindnesses upon us. And tonight here we are, we're together with your people at the end of this Lord's Day, and you've given us your word and you've given us your sacrament and you've given us your Holy Spirit to take that word and that sacrament and feed us and nourish us. As all your promises, we hear them by the ear, we see them with the eye, we taste them with our lips, we touch them with our hands, the promises of God towards those whom you love. So draw near to us, we pray, and make this hour to be an hour that is precious to us as we encounter you by the Spirit. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Please be seated. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, while angels may bless you in all of their sinless beauty, no angel in heaven can come before your throne as we do this evening as redeemed sons and daughters, bought by the blood of our Savior. And so we come to you in true humility, but also in great boldness, because you have opened the door of heaven to us by virtue of what you have accomplished on our behalf in the death and resurrection and ascension of our Lord Jesus. And so we ask this evening, as we hear his words spoken and preached upon, that you would give us soft hearts, open ears, and enable us, Lord, to grow in the grace and knowledge of the one who has redeemed your people. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We'll be reading this evening from Matthew chapter 15, verses 10 through 20. If you're using the Bibles that are in front of you in the pews, we're on page 821. This is Matthew chapter 15, verses 10 through 20. And he called the people to him and said to them, "Hear and understand. It is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but what comes out of the mouth. This defiles a person." Then the disciples came and said to him, "Do you know that the Pharisees were offended when they heard this saying?" He answered, "Every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be rooted up. Let them alone. They are blind guides. And if the blind lead the blind, both will fall into a pit." But Peter said to him, "Explain the parable to us." And he said, "Are you also still without understanding? Do you not see that whatever goes into the mouth passes into the stomach and is expelled? But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this defiles a person. For out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, slander. These are what defile a person. But to eat with unwashed hands does not defile anyone." These are the words of our Lord.
So because we have the Lord's Supper this evening, we go straight into the sermon, which is a good or a bad thing, depending on whether you're the preacher. So I don't have time to get myself all into the mood of it. And this evening, we're going to look at a subject that is almost the subject you would want to avoid at any cost. And the question for tonight is this: evil, nature or nurture? A number of years ago, there was a little girl disappeared, and as they searched for her, as investigations progressed, and as time passed, opinions swung one way or the other in terms of whether or not the parents knew about her disappearance or had perhaps a hand in her disappearance. And what struck me was the reaction that went something like this: if it turns out to be true that the parents were involved, then it would shake forever my belief in human nature. It was that expression, really, that caught my attention, and that's all that I want to say about that incident. As far as I know, she's never been discovered, and that the weight of evidence is not on her parents, but on her having been abducted for the sex trade somewhere in Africa. But it's this idea of, if it had been, it would shake forever my belief in human nature. So what do we believe about human nature? Do we believe that there's no such thing, that in fact we enter life with a blank slate, ready to be inscribed by the influences of our lives? Do we believe in human nature being the product of our environment, that our attitudes and our actions, our emotions and so on, are socially constructed? Change the experiences, change the input, you change the person. If only you're raised the right way, If only you have the right kind of education, well, you would turn out better than you have. Or is human nature simply the result of genetic determinism? We are what our genes say we are. Others take the view that things are not that simple, that we're the product of a whole range of factors: heredity, environment, neuron circuits, evolutionary flukes, and so on. Is there a Christian view of human nature? Yes, there is. The Christian view of human nature takes creation seriously. That is, we believe that people are made in the image of God, and that originally that image was perfect, harmonious, and happy. We take providence seriously. That is, we believe that our lives are not random, that the experiences we share, the circumstances that we face, have an effect on us, of good, for good or for bad. And we take sin seriously. Oh, I mentioned the S word, too early to keep your attention. But made in the image of God, we humans are foundationally moral, but that now our race has fallen into sin, and human nature is sinful nature. Of course, the word sin, I said, is unpopular. It is the most uncool, unhip, unpopular word to use in anyone's vocabulary. And you notice the range of time zones that I just passed through as I was undoing those things. Towards the end of the 19th century, people were quoting the theory of evolution as proof of humanity's maturity, that humanity was moving beyond its fierce and errant phase into an enlightened, peaceful period. People like Swinburne wrote the poem celebrating this triumph of the human spirit, the triumph of humanism over the base instincts of our bestial past. Glory to man in the highest, for man is the master of things. But that optimism that was generated towards the end of the 19th century into the early 20th century was going to be destroyed on the poppy fields of France and Belgium between 1914 and 1918. And that was only the beginning of a century of wars in which anti-God propaganda dominated. And during that period, there were in the region of 805 million people, 805 million people killed in wars and in genocide. People will often talk, don't they, of wars of religion. There was a 100 years war. There was a 30 years war in Europe. Both those wars saw many, many people killed. They were just a drop in the ocean compared to the wars and the genocide driven by fascism, communism mostly, in the 20th century. Well, it makes, as I say, the wars of religion seem like a Sunday school picnic. But in the middle of the 20th century, people then began to swing away from the optimism, and as a result of these wars going on, began to believe that there was no meaning in life at all. There was a great plunging into the depths of despair. The songs that were being sung were songs reflecting on the negativity of life, on the awfulness of life, on the horribleness of human experience. There is no meaning to life at all, was much of the thought that was going on in the songs of that period. I remember it well. I was alive for that period, I'm sad to say. Well, I'm not sad to say I was alive, but that I go back that far. Aldous Huxley, he was one of those who expressed this belief in the lack of meaning and purpose in life. He was honest enough to believe that, to say that his belief in the fact that life had no meaning served his own purposes of legitimizing his quest for sexual freedom. If there is no purpose in life, there are no restraints, there are no laws, there are no holds barred, there are no boundaries. So let's explore the boundaries. Because once you say that life has purpose, You are positing the idea of the existence of a higher authority and the power of that authority to tell you what is right and what is wrong. So the easiest thing is just to deny purpose and meaning altogether. Today, sin means something different entirely. Going by some of the ads on television, sin is calorific. It's the chocolate bar you really should avoid, but you're going to eat anyway. So what is sin? The Westminster Confession of Faith defines it as any transgression of or want of conformity to the law of God. So breaking the law or not measuring up to the law. But our question tonight is this: what is the cause of sin or evil in the world? Is it nature or nurture? You've got your Bibles open at Matthew 15. Glance down and look at the beginning of the chapter, and you'll see what sparks this particular story in the life of Jesus. It's his disciples, his followers. They've not been behaving. And those who have the power, those who are in power, the church leaders, observe that they're not behaving. It's the Sabbath day. And the Pharisees and the scribes, these religious leaders, come to Jesus from Jerusalem and said to him, "Why do your disciples break the tradition of the elders? Because they do not wash their hands when they eat." That was the problem. "We've noticed your people eat without washing their hands." And they base it, they come to Jesus and they say, "They're breaking the tradition of the elders." That's their expression, the tradition of the elders. In Mark's gospel, the tradition of men. In Matthew 15, later on, your tradition. Or in Galatians 1, the traditions of the fathers. What were these traditions? These traditions were an oral corpus of teaching, oral teaching, that commented on the law of God written in the Bible and interpreted the law of God written in the Bible, fine-tuned it. It helped it out by detailing rules of conduct. What does it mean when it says, do this or don't do that? This is what it means. And it began to enlarge on what these things meant. Jesus challenges these people. Look at verse 3. He answered them, "Why do you break the commandment of God for the sake of your tradition?" He challenges these people for putting human tradition, their thoughts, on the same level as God's thoughts, that is, divine revelation. He challenges their view of authority. He tells them what they're doing. They're pushing their tradition over Scripture. Of course, they wouldn't say that. They would say, "Oh no, God's word, God's talk, God's speech is absolute, and it's the final authority." But in practice, they were pushing their tradition not just up to equal with Scripture, but ahead of Scripture. And Jesus makes this great counterattack. He makes this radical distinction between the commandment of God on the one hand and your tradition on the other hand. And he charges them in verse 3 for breaking the former for the sake of the latter. Jesus challenges them for putting human rules on the same level as divine laws. And why were they doing that? Why did they make up these rules? Well, they made up these rules as a kind of protection for the law of God. It was a fence around the law of God to preserve it by addition. Jesus challenges them because instead of having a high view of sin, they had a low view of sin. They were actually deflecting attention away from the more stringent demands of God's holy law and focusing in on these addenda, these matters that were indifferent. I remember In fact, I remembered it coming in the car and tonight and told Christine, I was thinking, as I often do on a Sunday evening when we come into 10th, of the church I grew up in, which looks very like this and is just as dull and dark in the galleries as 10th is this evening, so that I can't see your eyeballs up there. But anyway, but as I was thinking of that, I was thinking of, we had a man who came to our church in Scotland as I was growing up. He was an Englishman. Well, he had that against him, number one. And number two, he smoked. And you could tell that from the smell off his clothes. And somebody had spotted him smoking at the side of the church. And he was a deacon. That's equivalent to an elder in a Baptist church, by the way. It was a Baptist church, so this might explain a lot of what I'm about to say. Well, immediately, you can imagine, immediately, this man was, he was blackballed. My mother said things about this man she should not have said. In the event, however, this man was probably one of the godliest men that we were ever going to meet. He ran the youth fellowship. He taught us the Bible. He modeled Christian compassion and behavior in so many ways. But the tradition of the elders obscured the godliness because we had our own means of classification. Well, that's perhaps a bad illustration, but it illustrates what's going on in the world today. We're rewriting morality today. In our world, living in Richmond and London, as I did for a number of years, it was immoral to let your dog poop on the sidewalk. There was about a $3,000 fine if that happened. That was serious criminology right there. It is immoral to leave a carbon footprint by using an airplane. But it is not immoral to have multiple sexual partners or to abort a baby or to indulge in unnatural affections or to use your employer's time and money and resources for your own purposes or to grind down the poor in order to get ahead in your career. And what happens in the church happens in the world, that when we find the law of God too demanding, we make up an alternative list of rules that are achievable and easier. Now, that's the background to what Jesus does with these people. In the end, Jesus universalizes the particular. What starts out as an exposure of the Pharisees for their hypocrisy, he uses that as a springboard to talk about the human heart. In verse 10, he's addressing the crowd. He called the crowd to him and he said to them, "Hear and understand, it is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but what comes out of the mouth." And he talks to them about the heart of the matter. What is the heart of the matter? When he uses this word heart, he's not talking about the organ that beats in your breast, nor is he simply talking about the heart used romantically as the seat of emotion, but it is the governing center of the human being. It is the human being at the center of his core existence. From the heart, says the book of Proverbs, flow the springs of life. Integrity is to have a pure heart. The perverse heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Jesus says sin starts in the human heart. It is our nature to sin. If sin lies in the heart, then it goes deeper than we thought. And Jesus is saying that it's comprehensive, that there's no part of human life that is untouched by evil. It is there, latent in every part of our being. Now, you would think that when Jesus talks here about from the mouth, that he's thinking about sins of speech. But in fact, he goes much deeper down. Evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, slander. That's the heart of the matter. The heart of the matter is a problem of the human heart. Very often the heart wants what it wants. Back in 1993, following or taking part in something that's now so common in Hollywood that we don't even critique it or criticize it at all in our society, Woody Allen explained his affair with the teenage daughter of his then partner, Mia Farrow. Explaining it to the press, what's the big deal? Why shouldn't I have sex with a minor? The heart wants what it wants. Those were his immortal words. The emperor me gets what it wants, no matter what cost to others. St. Augustine said of the human heart, homo incurvatus in se, man is turned in on himself. That is to say, he wants what he wants. He wants what pleases him. And in doing so, he debases himself. This is the basic problem of sin. We want the gifts of God. We don't care for the giver. We want meaning and security and joy and significance in life, which only God can give, but we don't want God in the equation. Our horizons are limited to our own imagination. By denying the transcendence of God, for settling for a God who fits my own categories, and recoiling from a God who blows my mind away because he is untamable, we've discovered that sin resides so deeply within us as to shape or dirty every thought, feeling, act, and will. Evil goes deep. We want what we want. And all evil, all sin is sin, although not all sin is equal. The Protestant has rejected the Roman idea of mortal and venial sins, because there's a sense in which all sins are mortal. The wages of sin is death. And sins that lead to death need not necessarily destroy, in fact, cannot destroy, justifying faith and grace in the believer. Having said that, we believe in degrees of sin. All sin is sin. That is, all sin is a breach of God's law and therefore an affront to his holiness and rebellion against his majesty, but not all sin is equal. The Bible abounds with gradations. We often don't. Bible does. You read the Old Testament law, and there are distinctions and provisions for penalties. There are different kinds of penalties for different kinds of acts. Some are perishable, are punishable by death, others by corporal punishment, others by the levying of fines, and so on. And in the New Testament, the Lord Jesus talks about gradations of punishment. It can talk about, for example, certain sins in the life of a member of the church that lead us in church discipline to, if they refuse to repent, to banning them from our presence and treating them as if they're not Christian at all. And yet it also talks about the kind of love in a fellowship that covers a multitude of sins. In other words, the Bible is recognizing that there are sins and there are sins. When the Bible talks about future judgment, it tells us that the judgment in the last day will take into account both the number, that is the quantity of our sins, and the severity, the quality of our sins. Jesus in his day talked about two cities, Chorazin and Bethsaida. He said, woe to you, Chorazin and Bethsaida, cities that he had visited again and again. If the mighty works done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, these infamous cities of the Old Testament, they would have repented long ago. It will be more bearable in the judgment for them than for you. But Jesus goes deeper. He goes right down to the polluted spring from which evil within us comes. He says, these are the things that defile a person. The language is the language of pollution. The media makes us aware of the trash and the chemicals and the toxins and the lifestyle choices and the manufactured goods and medicines that are going to do you more harm and the environment more harm than good. But what is the fundamental pollutant? Well, Jesus would say it's what comes from inside you. Sin is original to us. We could even say it's inherited. It has its roots in our conscious mind and deliberate will. It is part of our nature. The Bible has several words it uses to describe it. Total depravity does not mean we're as bad as we could be, but it does mean that every inclination of the thoughts of a man's heart are evil. It means that there is no part of me, intellectual or physical or psychological, that hasn't been damaged and tainted and dirtied by sin. And total depravity leads to total inability. It means that by myself, unaided by the grace of God and the help of God, unrenewed by the work of the Holy Spirit, it means that I will not want or be able to reach out to God. I will not want to reach out to God. It means, in the language that Paul uses again and again, there is no one righteous, no, not one. They defile a person. They contaminate a person. You consider that if we break God's moral law, you cannot even enter his presence. So you're excluded not only from the church, but you're excluded from his holy presence. Sin pollutes things. You introduce sin into a relationship, you break the relationship. You take songs and hymns that we sing, and you sing them just for entertainment, you pervert their purpose. And pollution spreads. Jesus said in this passage, the tree is known by its fruit. The father who sexually abuses his daughter defiles her. He corrupts her sense of self-respect and self-worth. He leaves her with a legacy she will struggle with for the rest of her life. Some sins introduce genetic disorders and even diseases that are passed on to children, grandchildren. Sins like racism, nationalism, in this worst sense, there's a good sense and there's a bad sense. Bigotry of all kinds can be passed on from one generation to another. Sin can even corrupt religion. It uses religious arguments for bad behavior. That's what the Pharisees were doing. Human nature. Can our sinful nature be nurtured? Yes, it can. It's nurtured by the world all the time. Trash in, trash out, as the old adage goes. There's a law of returns, an agricultural metaphor. You reap what you sow. How realistic is it for our boys growing up to be respectful in their treatment of women when their earbuds and brains and eyes have been filled with sexist sludge, which they're learning from the pillars of our society, from the actors and actresses on the screen all the time? It's nurtured by the devil. The devil, the old excuse, the devil made me do it, is unacceptable, by the way, to God. Satan cannot compel you to sin. Satan can only do what you let him do. He deceives the self-deceived. He seduces those who are in the market for seduction. He's a serious enemy. He's the prince of demons. He's the god of this age. But he is no match for Jesus the exorcist, the destroyer of the destroyer,
The one who rebukes, plunders, and intimidates Satan. But Satan is there to nurture within us that sinful nature. And then there are the powers. These are the hidden structures of society, the patterns of influence, the impersonal, superpersonal spirit of the age, which takes an institution, a tradition, a company, a nation, a political movement, even a church, and uses it to pull us away in that sinful direction. There is this invisible line where a gang or a crowd or a movement or a congregation or a group of people in the office or in the factory or the police or wherever it may be, on the street, becomes something that the individuals would never be and behaves in a way the individuals would never behave on their own. But there is a dynamism in bringing all that sin together that leads to violence, that leads the crowd to cry, "Crucify him, crucify him." Jesus takes sin seriously. And in the Bible, human nature needs restraining. Human nature needs restraining. The conscience is God's gift to help restrain the sin that lies within us. The moral law given to Israel in our Ten Commandments indicates what sin is, identifies how sin can be avoided. The moral law is meant to be a hedge to our behavior. The state, the powers that be, have been given the sword, that is the right of punishment, in order that they might preserve peace, punish wrongdoing, and promote good behavior. The civil law reduces bad behavior by putting penalties in place to curb it. But even the powers that are in place to curb bad behavior can themselves do evil. Human nature needs restraining. Human nature needs redeeming. Sin needs more than just to be restrained. It needs to be redeemed. You will never be persuaded that our race needs a redeemer till you are sure that we are sinners. Sin acts as a kind of narcotic, dulling our moral senses, diverting us from admiring moral beauty. So corrupted are we that we need to be delivered from ourselves. So condemned are we that we need to be delivered from judgment. And that means we need to stop covering up sin in ourselves and in other people. Covering it up will not do them any good, will not do you any good. We need to be honest to God. As long as we're in denial, as long as we're deflecting it onto minor faults or failings and regard it as inconsequential, there will be no salvation for us. What concerned Jesus was human nature. He came to save his people from their sins. And you can measure the seriousness of sin by contemplating the sufferings of Jesus that it took to redeem us from it. Many of us spend our time like the Pharisees looking for loopholes to dodge the implications of sin. We find euphemisms to explain it away. We find excuses for ourselves, for our friends, or for the people we admire on television to explain away their sin. But there are no loopholes. There is no way out except the one way that God has established, Jesus Christ, my sure defense, as the hymn writer puts it. There is forgiveness with you that you may be feared. Human nature needs redeeming. And human nature, thirdly and lastly, needs renewing. Jesus wanted to see people transformed and their hearts renewed. That can only come about by the new birth. You know, a man needs to be born again, Jesus said. There has to be this act of recreation, of renewal in the heart. Moral progress can only come through spiritual change. In the 18th century, in Britain, there was a complete moral collapse of the society in every
area of the society. This was something that's been explained by Harvard and Yale scholars as they've observed the British scene in that period. Every area of life. 80% of the population were in a state of intoxication and drunk all of the time. Immorality was rife everywhere. Life was cheap. Children were being abused and used. Slavery was the order of the day. It was the big industry of 18th century Britain. It was a terrible period. Britain was in such a degree that scholars have said that Britain was heading irrevocably towards a revolution that would have been at least as bloody as the French Revolution turned out to be. What stopped it? What stopped it was some field preachers who went out, John Wesley and George Whitefield, and they preached to the miners coming out of the mines. And they preached to the ladies of ill repute that hung upon the street corners. They preached to the aristocracy that was rife with sexual disease. And hundreds of thousands of people were converted. Their hearts were changed. They were renewed. And God preserved that country from spiraling into total chaos. The only thing that can actually change anything is that work of renewal, a new heart, a new creation, spiritual renewal. Evil needs the work of God's renewal in our heart. Human nature needs renewed. And that's, in many ways, precisely why we're here this evening. We believe that that's the business that God is in. God is in the business of capturing and consecrating and then transforming human nature, step by step, day by day, moment by moment, until we get less and Christ gets more and we are renewed into his likeness. Heavenly Father, we pray that you would pour out your Holy Spirit this evening. We pray that you would do this work of renewal within us. We struggle with sin every day. We struggle with evil. We're so easily caught up into the vortex of the debates and discussions and the things that are being said on the media, and we soak up that spirit of the age. We take advantage of our downtime with our laptop or with our iPad or with our phone and the opportunities it affords for us to do a bit of wandering into smut and sexual imagination. And we pray that you would help us to have the self-control to know how to shut that down, to take the help that we need from others to shut that down. We pray, Father, that you would cleanse our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we might worthily praise you and live for your glory. In Jesus' name.
Let's pray together. Father, we are grateful that you have reached into the depths of our souls by the word that is preached through the Spirit and caused that which was dead to be made alive. You've renewed us in the gospel in Christ, and we have much hope. This evening, as we come and offer our tithes and offerings unto you, would you use these for the glory of your name, for the extension of your kingdom, both here in our city as well as around the world? We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you. come to the Lord's table, that which Christ himself has ordained, a key means by which he strengthens his church, communicates his grace to us. In preparation, we come this evening using a question of preparation which comes from the Heidelberg Catechism. Question 78, you'll find that in your bulletin. I will read the question, and then together let's read the answer in unison. Are the bread and wine changed into the real body and blood of Christ? No. Just as the water of baptism is not changed into Christ's blood and does not itself wash away sins, but is simply God's sign and assurance, so too the bread of the Lord's Supper is not changed into the actual body of Christ, even though it is called the body of Christ, in keeping with the nature and language of sacraments.
So Christ is present in these emblems by the Holy Spirit to the believing heart. I invite all those who know and love the Lord Jesus and who are baptized members of Christ's church to share with us as we come around the Lord's table this evening. The Apostle Paul wrote, I receive from the Lord that which also I deliver to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you.
Why love the holy
bread of heaven is life for the world. Let's eat with thanksgiving. In the same way, he also took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Let's drink thanksgiving. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Let's together proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ died, Christ is risen. Christ shall come again. Thanks be to God. Now may grace, mercy, and peace from God, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with you now and evermore.